let's have a prayer before we begin our Bible story, okay? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this beautiful weather and for the sunshine. And Father, we thank you also for the rain when it comes. Father, thank you for your son, Jesus, who taught us to live lives of grace and courage and faith. And in his name we pray to you. Amen. Our Bible story today comes from the book of Esther, which is in the Old Testament, and it's one of the books of history. So it's really in the front one third of your Bible, kind of over on the left side. And it takes place at the same time of Zechariah. And you remember last week we were learning about Zechariah. We read from the book of Zechariah, and I said it was the second to last book in the Old Testament, that we were almost to the New Testament. So it seems weird that we would go from Zechariah to Esther. But what is hard to understand is that the Bible, the Old Testament, is not necessarily written in chronological or date order. The books of history are in date order, and then the books of prophecy are in their order, but they overlap. So while Zechariah was prophesying and talking and trying to encourage the people who had been in captivity in Persia for 70 years, you know, they came back to Jerusalem and tried and started rebuilding the temple, and then they kind of forgot and quit. And God told him to encourage the people and to prophesy to them about new things that were coming and better things that were coming. Well, that was the same time that Esther takes place. Esther was in Persia. She was one of the people who had been in captivity in Persia, one of the Jews who had been in captivity in Persia. In fact, Esther was born in captivity. At the time of this story that we're going to learn about today, she was probably about 20 years old. She was born while her parents were captives in Persia and never knew freedom, and she never really knew what it was like to live in Israel. Her parents died when she was young, and she was raised by a male cousin, a man named Mordecai. Mordecai taught her what it was like, what it was to be a Jew. He taught her the Ten Commandments, and he taught her about God and how to worship the one true God, who is not who the people of Persia around them were worshiping. The people of Persia looked down upon the Jewish people who were still living there. There was some prejudice there because they saw them as foreigners. They saw them as former slaves. And so things kind of got bad about the time Esther came to be an adult. Things looked really grim for a little while for the Jewish people. And that's what we're going to learn about today in our story. And our story tells us about how, even when things looked really bad for the Jews, God was in control. Let's watch our Bible story video now.
King Ahasuerus was the king of Persia. Many years earlier, when Cyrus was king, he sent some of God's people back to Judah to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. Some of God's people stayed in Persia. God's people were called Jews because they were from Judah. The king of Persia chose Esther to be his queen. Esther didn't tell the king that she was a Jew. One day, Mordecai heard that Haman, an important leader who worked for the king, was planning to kill all the Jews. Mordecai was upset. He was a Jew. He didn't want all the people he loved to be killed. Mordecai and all the Jews cried. Esther didn't know what was wrong. She sent a messenger to ask Mordecai why all the Jews were upset. Mordecai told Esther about Haman's evil plan. "You have to do something," Mordecai said. "Ask the king to stop Haman. Ask him to save the Jewish people." Esther sent a message back to Mordecai. "No one can approach the king unless the king calls for that person first," Esther said. "The punishment is death. Unless the king holds out his scepter, then you may live." "You're a Jew," Mordecai said. "If you don't stop Haman, he will kill you too. Maybe this is why you are the queen. Maybe God put Esther in the palace to save her people." Esther asked Mordecai and the Jews to fast for 3 days. Then Esther would go to the king, even if it meant she might die. On the third day, Esther went to the king. He saw Esther and held out his golden scepter. "What is it, Queen Esther?" the king asked. "What do you want to ask me? I'll give you anything, up to half of my kingdom." Esther said, "Would you and Haman come to a feast today?" So Haman and the king went to Esther's feast. After eating, the king said, "What do you want, Queen Esther? I'll give you anything, up to half of my kingdom." "Come to my feast tomorrow," Esther said. The king agreed. The next day, Haman and the king went to Esther's feast. After eating, the king said, "What do you want, Queen Esther? I'll give you anything, up to half my kingdom." Esther spoke up. "There is a plan to kill me and my people." The king replied, "Who is responsible for this plan?" "This evil enemy, Haman," Esther said. The king was angry. He punished Haman and made a law to keep the Jewish people safe from their enemies. God was in control over Haman's evil plan to destroy the Jews. Like Haman, Satan wants to ruin God's plan and destroy believers. Satan thought he had won when Jesus died on the cross, but God raised Jesus from the dead and defeated Satan once and for all. All who believe in Jesus are rescued from sin.
Our big picture question this month is, who is in control of everything? God is in control of everything in heaven and on earth. We will see today how God uses people to make things work the way He wants them to, even when it seems pretty hopeless to us. We also have a new key passage this month. Our key passage tells us that even though sometimes we have to go through some hard times, God restores things to right and supports us through it all. Life won't always be easy, but we will never be alone. Our key passage is 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10, almost at the end of your Bible. "The God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, will Himself restore, establish, strengthen, and support you after you have suffered a little while." I have someone I would like for you to meet now. She is a woman of great courage and faith. Just like we would be, she was afraid to do something that risked her life, but she prayed about it and she asked all of her community to pray for her. For 3 days, they fasted and prayed, and then she was able to do the right thing. That's a great lesson for us. Even when we are afraid, we can trust God to carry us through those hard times. The story comes from the book of Esther, and I think the most important verse in Esther's story to me for us to really think about is Esther, when she was afraid, before she had the courage to do the right thing, her relative, her cousin Mordecai said to her, "And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this." Meet my friend, the beautiful Queen Esther. You may need to use your imagination to see her as a young, beautiful woman that the king would choose over all other women. But I know that you have good imaginations and you have big hearts and that you can learn from our friend Esther. Greetings. I am the beautiful Queen Esther. Remember, your teacher told you needed to use some imagination. Well, I want to tell you my story. My husband, the king, had a wife, a queen named Queen Vashti, and she disobeyed him one time, and he was so angry, he banished her from the kingdom, and he sent her away forever. And then he needed a new wife, and he searched for a new wife. He had representatives from every province in the entire country of Persia, which was the largest country in the world at that time, to select the most beautiful young women from their towns and their lands and bring them to the palace to compete for the king's favor and to be chosen as the next queen. It was kind of like the Hunger Games, except without all the killing. Obviously, because of my great beauty, I was sent from my home province to the palace. For 12 months, we were fed the best food, given maids to take care of everything we needed. We had skin treatments and beauty treatments and the best cosmetics and oils and perfume. It was like a giant spa day that lasted for a whole year. Then, at the end of that year, each woman, one day at a time, was taken before the king so that he could choose who he wanted to be his next wife. Each day, a different beautiful young woman was brought to the king for his approval. When he saw me, he fell in love. It was love at first sight, of course. So he chose me. He put the crown on my head and said, "You are now the queen of Persia." Now, my cousin Mordecai had warned me before I left to go to the palace. He said, "Do not tell anyone that you are a Jew. If the king finds out you're a Jew, he might not choose you to be the queen." So I didn't tell him. I mean, nobody asked. It just never really came up. Well, Haman was the king's second in command. He was an evil, evil man, and he did not like Mordecai. He wanted everyone in the country to bow down to him whenever he rode by on his horse. Mordecai would not bow down to him because we are Jews and we do not bow down to anyone except the one true God. Because Haman hated Mordecai so much, he convinced the king to let him make a law that would have all the Jews in the entire land of Persia killed all on one day. He wrote out this law and got the king to sign it. On one single day, March 7th, all over all the provinces of Persia, stretching from India to Ethiopia in Africa, all the Jews would be killed on that day. It was terrifying. When Mordecai learned of this plot, he was so upset. And then when all of the Jews began to hear about this and learn about this law and this plot, and they knew that the day was coming, there was great mourning and fear all over our part of the world. Can you imagine how frightening it would be? Oh, Mordecai sent a messenger to me and he said, "Esther, you must talk to the king. You must ask him to stop this law that he has signed." I couldn't do it. I was too scared. I sent the messenger to tell Mordecai, "I cannot do this. No one can approach the king unless he invites them to come into his throne room. I haven't even seen him in weeks. He doesn't even know I'm a Jew, remember?" Mordecai was not letting me get away that easy. He replied, "Just because you are safe in your pretty palace right now does not mean that you always will be. When all of the Jews are killed, you may be too. Esther, do you think that perhaps you were placed in the royal palace for such a time as this?" I knew that Mordecai was right. Even though I was really afraid of being banished like Queen Vashti or worse, being killed, I knew that I had to ask the king to stop killing the Jews. I asked Mordecai and all the Jews in town to pray for me and fast for 3 days, and so did I. We prayed and we fasted to God for strength for 3 days. At the end of that 3 days, I put on my most beautiful dress, and I went and I stood outside the door of the throne room where the king could see me. And when he looked up and he saw me, he smiled and he invited me in. Oh, what a relief. So I walked up to the king and he held out his golden scepter to me. And that meant that he wanted to hear what I had to say. Oh, I was so thankful. He said, "My beautiful queen, how I love you. I want to give you anything you want. Anything up to half of my kingdom is yours. All you have to do is ask. And I said, King, would you please come to dinner with me tonight? And would you please bring your friend Haman, just the three of us, to have a big banquet, me, you, and Haman? And the king said, yes. That night at the banquet, I told the king the truth about Haman and his evil plan. I told him that Haman wanted to kill Mordecai and he wanted to kill all the Jews and that I was a Jew too. I said, he tricked you into signing that law just to keep himself happy and to get back at his enemy, Mordecai, who just wouldn't bow down to him. Oh, the king was furious at Haman. He said, you are so sneaky and devious, you're out of here. And he sent Haman away to be executed. Then a new law was written. The king wrote a new law himself that said, no Jews are to be executed. And it was sent out by horseback to all of the provinces just in time to keep the Jews from being killed on that day, March 7th. That day, March 7th now, is a holiday called Purim, and we celebrate it with feasts and with cookies and with giving gifts to the poor to celebrate the beautiful gift that God gave us, our freedom and our lives, because God had saved his people once again. I am so happy that I overcame my fear and that I stood up to that bully and I trusted God to do the right thing. I think you Christians have a verse that goes, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And you know what? That is true. You can do anything when you pray to God and ask for his strength and to do it in his will. Do you know, God has placed you right where you are, in the place and the time that you are right now, for such a time as this. God has plans for you, and you can make a difference in your home, in your family, and in your community.